Today we start a two-part series on That's G. Pastor Eric's done that last couple of years, and he asked me if I would preach this morning, kind of bat lead off. Hopefully I'll get us on base and he can bring it home next week, all right? How many of you have seen the Pixar cartoon Inside Out? Okay, bunch of you. If you haven't, it's a great film. And so for those of you that haven't seen it, I'm going to play a clip. It's the movie trailer. And for those of you that have, it's kind of a reminder because I want to play off of that this morning. So if you guys would play that video clip.
Did you guys pick up on that?
Sure did.
Something's wrong.
Signal the husband.
Uh-oh. She's looking at us. What did she say?
Oh, sorry, sir. No one was listening.
Is it garbage night? We left the toilet seat up. What is it, woman? What?
I'm joy. This is sadness. That's anger.
What?
This is disgust. And that's fear. Ah! We're Riley's emotions. These are Riley's memories. They're mostly happy, you'll notice, not to brag.
I wanted to maybe hold one.
What happened? Sadness?
She did something to the memory.
Is everything okay?
I don't know.
Can't get back, Joy!
I'm trying.
Joy, no,
let
wait!
The core memories!
Ah! No!
Can I say that curse word now?
What do we do now?
Nothing's working. Why isn't it working?
We have a major problem.
Oh, I wish Joy was here.
We can fix this. We just have to get back to headquarters.
That's long-term memory. You could get lost in there.
Think positive.
Okay. I'm positive you will get lost in there.
What was that? Was it a bear?
There are no bears in San Francisco.
I saw a really hairy guy. He looked like a bear.
This place is huge.
Imagination Land?
No way. Dream Productions?
Rainbow Unicorn.
She's right there.
I loved you in Fairy Dream Adventure Part 7. Okay, bye. I love you.
They can't focus on what's going wrong. There's always a way to turn things around.
It's broccoli.
Congratulations, San Francisco. You ruined pizza.
The birthday girl!
Ah!
Brain freeze!
Ah! Hang on! Finally, here we come!
That's fun. You need to see it if you haven't seen it. The writer-director of that film, actually, it kind of came out of some of his own life experience. When his daughter was 11, he was kind of trying to figure out what are all these mood swings and everything's going on with her. And so he did a lot of brain research and talked with psychologists and different things. And so the film is actually based on some actual brain research and that type of thing. Now, it's obviously a commercial cartoon, all right? It's not made for a science class. So I want you to think more big picture as opposed to all the little the pieces of that are more imaginative with him. In the brain, there's actually over 100 billion neurons. And those neurons, hello, there we go. And those neurons connect with a place called a synaptic connection, all right? And there's over 10,000 synaptic connections. And there are at least 50 neurotransmitters that communicate information back and forth between them. Now, here's the point. When those neurons fire together, they wire together. That's what happens. They make a connection. And it's kind of like when you are out driving around and you see all of the construction that's going on and they're building those overpasses and they've got the pillars that they put in play And then the next thing they do is they have that crane and they'll connect those pillars, right? And so you're laying the road like that. And that's literally kind of what happens in the brain. We're making all of these connections. Now, what's interesting is in the cartoon, you've got five characters there, all right? You've got fear and anger. You've got sadness, disgust, and who did I leave out? Joy, all right? And depending on what research you want to read, there are four, five, or six primary emotions that everybody has, and he built that on five. I happen to think there's six. You know what the sixth one is? Surprise! It's surprise, okay. But I think there's six, but whether there's four, five, or six, those primary emotions are what fire with any life experience. And then out of that comes a natural response. You often hear the fight, flight, and freeze kind of thing. Yeah, it's a natural kind of thing that we do with those primary emotions. I either engage something, I want to engage the joy, I fight with anger. I want to disengage, I'm disgusted about what's going on. I freeze, I don't know what to do with what's going on. All right? So that's what happens for all of us. Now, that's all in the limbic system. It's not some control panel like they've got going on up there, which would be really cool in the cartoon. But what happens next is the prefrontal cortex gets involved. Now, the prefrontal cortex is where we have all of the judgment and logic and reason and processing like that. Okay? And so it fires, but what develops first with us is the limbic system. And actually, the prefrontal cortex isn't fully developed till they think mid to late 20s. So the next time you look at your kid and go, "What were you thinking?" They weren't. Okay. They hadn't developed yet, all right? That's why us teenage boys, we're having a conversation, or a day, the teenage boys and college guys, we do all these stupid stuff. And you go, "Why'd you do that?" "Well, I don't know." All right? So, yeah, that's what's happening for all of us. And so I have an emotional response to something, and now I think about it, and now I attach some feelings to that, and I make some decisions about behavior next time. Then something exactly like it or similar to it happens. Now I reevaluate it. I analyze it. And I make some decisions about good idea, bad idea, did I feel the right way, did I not feel the right way. So what happens over a period of time is with all of what's happening with life experiences, with the emotions that are firing and the thought that's taking place, the feelings about things become reinforced. And my beliefs become solidified. Behaviors get set. Patterns and habits are formed, and the result is kind of a mixed bag of good, bad, and ugly, godly and ungodly, right and wrong, lots of different variables at play, lots of different things going on for me, and so I get a worldview gets established and actions and beliefs are set in play. Now, once they get laid down, those roads get laid down in our life, and the repetition takes place with that, those feelings, beliefs, patterns, and habits don't change unless I have a compelling reason to do so. They don't. It becomes very much like the rides at the amusement parks for the little kids, where they're in the car, and there's this, you know, this trail, and the steering wheel moves on their little car, but it's actually sitting on a rail of some sort, you know, and it's kind of doing this. The kid thinks they're driving. They're not driving, it's just following the path. And that's literally what happens with our brain. We've laid out all of these pathways, and that's the route I'm going to go just naturally. I don't have to think about it. And the only way that changes if it is interrupted intentionally. It's the only way it changes. So, what does this have to do with generosity? Glad you ask. Our default setting, is it generosity? No. What's our default setting? Selfishness, all right? You don't have to teach your kids to be selfish, do you? You need to get more selfish. Stop being so generous. No. We all, you know, it's the two-year-old mentality, right? What's mine is mine, and what's yours is mine if I want it. And so we don't grow out of that, we actually grow into that. And so we become adult versions of the two-year-old. I want what I want when I want it, thank you very much. So selfishness is our default setting, and that's where I go without having to think about it. Generosity, that's something I have to learn. What's that proverb? Train up a child in the way that they should go. All right? Because my default setting is not the way I should go. Now, if you've been around here much the last few weeks or few months, put up the discipleship loop. It's in your bulletin. You've seen this before. We've been talking about it a lot. And one of the things that we've been talking about with growing in Christ is it's a process that happens. And it's a process that goes from me being very, very selfish and self-centered to more God-centered. And that's a process that happens. And one of the movements that we've been talking about from simply following Christ to truly being a disciple of Christ. That's where we've talked about in John 6, where Jesus says some really hard things to all of those who were following him. He does it right after the feeding of the 5,000. And they're wanting more from him. And he talks to them about some hard stuff, some sacrifice kinds of thing. And it says in John 6, from that day forward, many of them left and didn't follow him. And Jesus turns to the 12 disciples and goes, you going to leave too? And that's where you have the confession of Peter. Where are we going to go? You alone have the words of eternal life. And so they start learning that it's not just about what Jesus is going to do for them. It's about what Jesus is going to do through them. That's a different thing. And one of the verses that we settled on to try to explain that and understand that is Romans 12, 1 and 2. And the first part of that verse talks about sacrifice of our bodies, our lives, but I want to focus in on the second part of the verse today, which says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. Do not be conformed. Don't be molded. Don't be shaped into the patterns of this world. The patterns of this world, are they selfless? No. Are they godly? No. You see, not only is my default setting selfishness and ungodliness, that's the default setting of our culture, of our world around us. So it's really easy to go there. And Paul's saying, don't be shaped and conformed and molded to the selfishness and the patterns of selfishness and ungodliness in your own life and in your world, but be transformed. Now, you've seen some of those Transformer movies, right? Okay, just checking. All right. I mean, what's the idea of transform? It's in this shape, and then it turns into that shape, right? It looked like this, now it looks like that. We're supposed to transform. We're supposed to change from one thing to something else. How? By the renewing of your mind. It's actually retraining the brain. That's why I started there. Renewing of the mind requires me to retrain the brain. I'm on the kiddie car ride, and it just goes the way of selfishness automatically. I don't have to think about that. But for me to have a different default setting, that requires me to literally retrain the brain. That's what renewing the mind means. And it says, by testing, you may discern. You can find out. You can learn. In other words, it is a process, not an event. I wish it was an event. Got or did. Here we go. Nope, it's a process. And as a result of that process, I can know what is good. The word good there is talking about pleasant and joyful. I can know what is good, what is acceptable. It's pleasing. And it's perfect, the complete, whole, lacking nothing will of God. Romans 12:2 in the New Living Translation says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. I'm allowing the Lord Jesus Christ to literally change the way I think, the way I process it, what I value, to give me a default setting that is not natural, it is supernatural. It's a different way to think, it's a different way to be. And see, I've got to retrain the brain to change how I think. In other words, that's G from the inside out. That's G from the inside out. Now, we tend to think of generosity as an action. Thus the expression, that's G. And that's good, all right? However, what I want you to do today, and as you move forward, I want you to think beyond simply actions. See, an ungodly natural person can occasionally be generous. I had a conversation recently with a person that is really trying to overcome some great confusion because a very important person in their life, a grandparent, they had perceived as incredibly loving and generous until they lived with them. And then it was kind of like the Wizard of Oz, they saw behind the curtain and how all of that generosity, quote unquote, was simply manipulation, greed, getting, having. It really wasn't generosity, not godly generosity. You see, that's G is who we are supposed to be. Say that again. That's G is who we're supposed to be. So the actions that flow out of who we are, that's G. Why? Because we be G. Staying alive, staying alive. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. That's who I'm supposed to be. I'm supposed to be generous, all right? Not just act generous. It's supposed to flow out of my identity. See, it's not an occasional choice based on how I feel at the time or what I'm thinking at the moment. It's supposed to be descriptive of who I am every day. That's the way I'm supposed to be. Not something I'm supposed to occasionally do. So, therefore, it's got to be an ongoing process for me for that to happen. So that's Jesus, an ongoing process. It's an ongoing process of removing the selfish, destructive, ungodly habits and patterns like greed and adding the godly, healthy habits and patterns like generosity. It's an ongoing process of both, what needs to be removed and what needs to be added. Now, I find it really interesting. I did some research on habits and acquiring habits, removing habits. What I was really surprised is there's not a lot of really good research that's actually been done. Okay, especially on the new habit piece. How many of you have ever heard 21 days to a new habit? A lot of you have heard that. Now, that's not based on research. That's based on the opinion of Dr. Max Maltz in 1960, his book, Psycho-Cybernetics. But it's been quoted over and over. I can't tell you how many times when I was Googling, 21 days, 21 days, 21 days, 21 days. I go, what? Really? Well, I did find one research study, but it was kind of sort of research because it's self-reporting. All right? Self-reporting research. So, but at least they did some research, even though it's self-reporting. It was done at the University College London 2009, and they had 96 participants. And those 96 participants were going, they were going to see how long did it take for a new habit to actually be a habit for them. The best time anybody had was 18 days. The longest it took somebody, again self-reporting, was 254 days. That one was probably the truthful guy. All right. The average was 66 days. Now that's probably somewhere in the neighborhood of about right for a new habit that I really want to instill. Now, new habits you really don't want, not so much. I mean, I don't want to exercise. Do you? No. Okay, there's a few of you out there. You're addicted to it. I know you. Okay. You're the ones that's always getting in my face and giving me shame. Yeah. But I hate to exercise. I do it, but I don't like it. And let's see. Are there anybody here, and I don't raise your hands, that have started out on those diets? And I'm going to do it this time. Yeah, buddy. The chocolate is calling me. It knows my name. So, a new habit that I really want to instill, probably about 2 months, all right, for it to actually become a habit. Now, old habits, they die hard. Totally, yeah, there you are. I got a witness in the house. Man, I think the old habits and the old patterns are more like what it's the brain research tells us about what it takes for someone who's addicted to something to have the success of living free from that. Had a conversation recently with a friend of mine who runs a drug rehab place, and he said, their research indicates that someone who's motivated to go into a drug and alcohol recovery and wants to be free from it, They go in for a 30-31 day rehab. They come out and don't do any aftercare. They had 31 days of intense focus, come out, don't do any aftercare. Their success rate, the ones that are motivated, 10%. 90% failure rate. Now, the ones that aren't motivated, guess what that success rate is? Can you say zero? Now, their research also shows that someone who has been sober for a year, they've been disciplined and sober for a year, their success rate is now 50%. 2 years, 90% success rate. In other words, it doesn't happen overnight, do it? I wish it did. There's a retrain the brain piece, a renewing of the mind piece. And it requires of me a daily, intentional process to really get to the place that I would like to go. Now, therefore, That's G requires an action plan for me, because it isn't going to just happen. I don't wake up and just, that's G. It's an action plan required of me. I have to intentionally remove the selfish, destructive, the ungodly, my presets of greed, and I've got to intentionally add the godly, good habits of generosity. So, there's both a removing piece and an adding piece. Now, this morning, I'm not going to talk about the removing piece. What I want to do is refer you back to three messages I preached in August. What you don't know can and will hurt you. Because this really has to do, the removing and tearing down piece has to do with strongholds that are entrenched into our lives, that are reinforced, our sin is reinforced by darkness, and we need an effective strategy to tear that down and remove that. So I want to refer you back to that for the removing piece, okay? And I want to remind you that that's not an event, it's a process. So even if you have spent time doing that, let me invite you to revisit that, just like you do spring cleaning in your house. You need to revisit that every once in a while, because we kind of collect junk and stuff, don't we? So there's what needs to be moved away and moved aside, and what needs to be put in, the renewing of the mind. And so, again, it's got to be daily and intentional for that to happen. All right? Now, at the foundation of that change, the renewing of the mind, I'm going to tell you what you already know. Word of God and prayer. You're not going to get there without the Word of God and prayer. It ain't going to happen. See, time in the Word every day is not just a good idea. It's vital. And so let me challenge you to at least spend 10 minutes a day in the Word. Now, devotional books are great, and every morning I have two or three that I read. But I'm also in the Word. You need to be in the Word every day. And then prayer is an ongoing conversation all day long. I need to be listening to him all day because my default is selfishness. And I want to transform and renew my mind, so I need to be talking with him. And by the way, when you're reading the word, you're not just reading the word, he is speaking to you. If you haven't thought about it like that, think about it like that. You know, it's amazing. He can actually speak to me out of the book of Leviticus. I mean, are you kidding me? You ever read through Leviticus? You probably did on your journey to read through the Bible. Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and lions and tigers and bears. Oh my, I don't know. Gee, none of you have been there. Okay. You see, I need to be in the Word every day because choosing to act on the truth of God's Word, that's a faith response. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. That's a faith response. It's not a natural thing. It's a supernatural thing. And the cool part is, God desires to build that supernatural component in me and through me and with me and for me so that I get to see Him do amazing stuff. I get an education, He gets a reputation. Because it's supernaturally transforming how I think and what I think about. So that's the foundation of everything. But today, to be specific about generosity. So you be G. All right? For it to be a part of your character, there's a lot of things that would be helpful. When you're praying for someone, that's generosity. You're giving a cup of cold water. That's G. You're letting somebody go in front of you. That's G. You're not making censored response to those who cut you off. That's G. I could go on. There's a lot of those kinds of things, and you really need to look for that every day. But because where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. I want to speak specifically to some money matters when it comes to building a mindset of generosity. So, to be strategic, you need to have some annual and seasonal strategies concerning your resources. For example, play that video clip.
We've been talking about that's G. When we talk about being G, we talk about being generous. And there's not a better time about generosity and Thanksgiving Christmas. Because it's the time of year to celebrate what God did by sending His Son Jesus to pay a debt for us that we couldn't pay on our own. Thanksgiving and Christmas is also a time when we spend more than any other time of the year. And it's sometimes that can create some habits that aren't really good for us to have. In fact, advertising not only encourages us to spend in order to give more, but also to get more. Why? Because everything's on sale. And so why don't we just go ahead and grab it and get it? So as we are shopping for friends and longing to give to others, we also begin to get a lot more. So here's my challenge to you this year, is that you would give over and above your regular gifts to the church in order to break the power of greed and create some of the disciplines in spending that are important for us to have as believers. Laura and I have been doing this the last couple of years, and it has been a wonderful thing for our family. Not only does it provide some discipline in our spending, but it puts greed in its place. But we also know when we give back to our church that there's some incredible things that come out of that. There's some wonderful ways that we help children right here in our neighborhood as well as the nations beyond. So again, would you consider giving a gift over and above your regular giving to LABC so that we can be known as a people who are G and a church who is full of generosity?
We need an annual plan and strategy. We need a seasonal plan and strategy. And just like Eric talked about, this is a great season for you to have a strategy of building generosity in your life. I recommend that you also have a weekly and a monthly plan. I suggest that you start with the idea of a tithe. I don't know if you ever really thought about it, but the tithe, that 10% idea of the resources God has entrusted me to manage, that's not for God. Guess who that's for? That's for me. That's for me to not only participate in the mission and ministry of what God's doing, but it's to build generosity in my life rather than greed. Now, you may be living on 110% of your income. Start somewhere. Do something rather than nothing would be a good plan. And then, on a daily basis, let me just suggest, you remember how energized the church was and how you loved all of the stories back at Easter where we gave people a $100 bill and we said, go invest that in other folks. Remember that? Some of you did that. What if you were to ask the Lord, how do I need to invest in the lives around me and in the marketplace of my life, whatever that looks like, every day? Now, if you start giving out $100 bills, my name is Ed Laymance, and how you get, no, you understand what I'm saying. It's not about $100 bills. It's about you being generous for those around you. But don't just look for how you need to be generous with those around you. If you've never considered, you need to be asking the Lord throughout the day, where do I eat and what do I eat? Is it okay to have this? Is it not okay to have this? Now, I really love the fact that the Lord will, sometimes I'll go, is it okay for me to have this toy? He goes, yeah, go play. Yes. Now, I'm like any other kid. When he says no, I go, huh? I want what I want. And I do my two-year-old routine on the inside. Or I can learn to go, okay. It's not just about what you give. It's about what you don't go get and don't chase after. He desires, Luke 6:38 says, give and it shall be given unto you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, full and overflowing, will it be poured into your laps, for with the measure you give, it shall be given unto you. God desires to bless generosity way beyond anything I could ever begin to understand or imagine. You see, the bottom line is the law of the harvest. I've talked about that before, but it's not rocket science. We're not farmers in here. But the law of the harvest is you get what you plant. You get more than you plant, and you get later than you plant. That's the way it works. You don't plant cotton and hope to grow wheat. You put out some seed and it grows to more. And it takes a while to grow. You're very familiar with this verse out of Galatians 6:7. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. Law of the harvest. Question is, what do you want to grow? What do you want to grow? Hebrews 12:2 says of Jesus, for the joy that was placed before him, he endured the cross and the shame. See, being a disciple means I go through some tough stuff. I'm supposed to take up my cross and follow him daily. Why? For the joy. And since we kind of had a hoedown section in the music today, you want the joy, 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 joy down in your heart? Or do you want the song from Hee Haw? Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Whoa! Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. Whoa! If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Whoa! Gloom, despair, and agony on me. What do you want to grow? Our soul cries out from the inside out for the joy of the Lord. Generosity from the inside out. I think I would call that a no-brainer. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, it is so easy to be selfish. I don't have to think about it, and my brain is trained to go there. But you've declared that you have for us exceedingly abundantly far beyond that. It's not the song of Hee Haw. It's the joy that you desire for us. May we think different. May we see different. May we allow you to be in our lives who you are and do what only you can do. To truly, supernaturally retrain the brain. And as a result, experience the amazing joy that only comes from you, through you, and by you. Thank you. Now, this is not the kind of message where folks flood the aisles and come down to pray. But hopefully it's the kind of message that's caused you to pause and think, where am I in this process? Am I allowing Most High God to retrain my brain? Do I have a strategy of removing what needs to be removed and putting in play what needs to be put in play? Do I have a plan? I would hope that today you make a decision to do something rather than nothing for the joy that only God can bring. Would you stand with us? Staff will be here. Some prayer partners will be here. There may be something that would be helpful to pray with you about or talk with you about that has nothing to do with this message today. Maybe there's someone that you really care about and really love And you're saying, would you join us in praying for them and with them? Maybe God's brought you to be a part of this church, and you'd like to come and talk about that. God desires to break you free from whatever chains are there so you can have the freedom that He intends. They're going to sing. You sing with us. You come.